today, please allow me to be mildly provocative by saying that there is no single individual more important than Kubasi Wijai for understanding the history of Northern Thailand in the 20th century. Indeed, he is called a Tonbun, or saint of Lana. No person more important for understanding the impact of Thai nation state formation on ordinary people, the appropriate raising issues which continue to the present day about the appropriate role of monarchy, the role of the military, the appropriate relationship between Sangha and state, and the role of education. No single person more important for raising questions about the process of Thai historiography, namely how Thai history is, the process of Thai historiography, namely how Thai history is either remembered or forgotten, and how key dates are recorded. I also hope that even though my talk is focused on Kubasi Wijai, you will see ways in which his life intersects with many of the topics that you will be presenting at this conference, be they papers on history, politics, religion, architecture. I saw one at Wundt's event. I happen to be really into cement these days. Economics, education, language, or cultural change. Young Nai. Kubasi Wijai lived from 1878 to 1939. His life spanned. His life spanned the periods of both absolute monarchy and constitutional monarchy. He experienced temple arrests in both periods, culminating in investigations in Bangkok in 1920 and 1935 through 36. Despite its obvious drama, little attention has been paid to the second investigation, which involved literally hundreds of monks being disrobed, fleeing, and jailed. Among them, this is Kuba Wong being disrobed, the temple mural painting. So there he is, disrobed. And Kuba Kaupi, who was disrobed three times and finally wore white the rest of his life. Here he is being processed. His body is kept and has been gilded and is processed. And the same with Kuba Wong. His body is also kept to the present day and processed. But there were many others who, some continued after they were disrobed to wear white. Some fled to the hills until they felt it was safe to return after a couple of years. Others fled to Burma. Wow, we're gonna die because I have 200 images. and others disrobed and became just ordinary villagers. So this is the abbot at Wat Nam Bolung in Sampathong, and his uncle was one of the ones who was forced to disrobe. He refused initially and then was summoned by the Jokana Jangwat in Tongyu in Chiang Mai. And he described how his uncle, who was the abbot, and the various monks and novices they marched in procession in into Chiang Mai, and then the relatives asked if they would be allowed to keep the robes after they disrobed in order to be able to pay respects to them. And Jaffanap Changwat denied that, took the robes, and wrote the name of the abbot on it and hung it over the walls at Wat Tong Yu so that everybody could see that this monk had also been disrobed. They then returned home with the monks wearing white and the relatives in tears. So now I want to turn to the historiography of how Kubasi Wijaya is being remembered today. There are thousands of people that go to his shrine at the foot of the road going up to Wapatat Doi Suthaya, asking for children, asking to pass exams, asking for jobs, any number of things. Some are asking for political dreams. Any number of things that people will pray for at this shrine. His statue is showing up all over town. All temples that had nothing to do with Siwijaya have altars and images of him. Great. That was a picture of just in a local store, pictures that you can buy that are for sale in Siwijaya. Calendars, keep people safe in cars. There are all kinds of monks that lay claim to being part of his lineage, wearing his amulet. There are these enormous statues being erected. This is at Wat Doi Kui in Ampu Muang Lumpur, just to give you a sense of how enormous it is. This is in Wei Fapao, Chiang Rai. And here's a newer one with Kuba Kalpi and Kuba Wong. Now they're starting to celebrate his birthday on the 11th of June. So widely known, but people have different levels of knowledge. So there's some people that will say, yes, he built lots of temples, like over 100 temples. In Chiang Mai, something on the order of 50. Chiang Rai, Paiyao, something on the order of 20. Ampang, over 20. And Ajahn Pensapa and her group can tell you that actually the number is not really known. It seems to be even more. But it was all over throughout the north. And these included famous temples like Wapasing, Wat Son Dog, Wapatat Doi Suthaya. And he's well known, lots of people will know him for the road that he built going up Doi Suthaya to the temple at the top. These are famous pictures that most people in Chiang Mai will have seen. And if you're a red shirt, you may also have special feelings about Kubasi Wijaya that sort of got popularized through the voice of Thaksin. He's on the cover of the January 2010 issue, special story about him in the February 2010 issue. Candidates for Pakutai, before they registered for the election, went to pay their respects at the shrine. Here in Chiang Mai, Ying Hak Chinhuan, before she started her campaign, she began it at the shrine and ended it at the shrine. And then people protesting the coup thought that was the logical site to gather. And before one starts to think, oh, Kubasi Wijaya is just part of a northern movement, as I was preparing this talk, I was Googling away and I came across this. This is Kuba Wijaya Kalpi, in other words, Kalpi, Kuba Kalpi. So a monument built to honor his achievements and sacrifices in the reunification of Thailand. So I need to go there and find out how that, the logic there is. He's generally sort of remembered as a magical monk with particular powers, sort of part of a broader pantheon of monks, known for having powerful amulets, made possible because of his strict discipline in following the Vinaya and meditation, his food habits, being a vegetarian, eating only once a day, all of which contribute to having magical powers. So Kubasi Wijaya was apparently able to float in the air. He didn't get wet in the rain. He could see into the future, see into the past, etc. These are powers of a lot of the bodhisattvas bodhisattvas or saints around the world. But when we think about it, it's also interesting, when we start thinking about him as a saint, to think about how saints elsewhere are portrayed. And saints can also be sages with tremendous insight into religious texts, etc. But that's not one of the associations with Kwabasi Wijaya, even though he was abbot at Wampasing for 13 years. This is gonna drive us all crazy. He wrote Mailan at this very chair, and yet nobody seems to be particularly interested in understanding what his teachings were. What was his philosophy? What did he write about? Why isn't this also important? One of the texts you may have written. Christian saints tend to be martyrs, people who suffered for their beliefs, imprisoned, tortured, even executed. And Kwabasi Wijaya certainly was detained under temple arrest enough times. This is a wood carving of the detention at Wat Pathari Punjai in Lumpur. So when people do know something about his detentions, they tend to focus on the first detention. And the prevailing explanations are all Sangha-based. So he must have had some kind of a conflict with the local level monk, the Jokhonep Kwang of Ampuli. There was jealousy. Other people say, well, no, the conflict was actually with the Sangha at the national level, seeking to impose the 1902 Sangha Act, Rasa Nung Song, which should not be confused with Rasa Nung Song, Dio Tu Yung. So this act was to incorporate northern monks into the administrative hierarchy, so the argument goes. And then there are other people that just say, Kwabasi Wijaya was just an ignorant village monk. He didn't know all these fancy regulations. It was just a simple misunderstanding. He didn't know that he wasn't supposed to be ordaining people. Problem with this argument are threefold. First, the Sangha Act of 1902 did not apply to Monton Payap until 1926, and Kwabasi Wijaya was already under investigation in Bangkok in 1920. So that doesn't work. And if anybody had bothered to read the Sangha Act, it doesn't mention anything about ordination. Another minor problem. And when you actually look at the response of the Central Thai Sangha, it was actually, the Sangharat was actually quite supportive of Kwabasi Wijaya. There's almost no mention of the second detention, which was actually a really serious detention of 1935 and 36. No mention, or hardly ever any mention, of the mass disrobings that took place from February to April of 1936. Which I find amazing, considering he's arrested right after he's built something over 100 temples. He's in the middle of this road up Doi Suthep, which he was able to complete in 5 months, in 22 days. Why would he be arrested then? What was going on? Why isn't this something that people are talking about and want to know more about? And this date, April 21st, 1936, Kwabasi Wijaya signs a document in Bangkok. He's not allowed to return to the north until he agrees to sign this document, in which he agrees to abide by the act controlling monks, namely he's going to agree to submit the names of monks, he's going to agree to abide by the national Sangha rules about ordination, he's not going to build any more temples without getting permission first, and he's going to assist with the Primary Education Act to assist in building schools and in convincing the people of the benefits to be derived from education. So, just to give you a sense of his biography, so I've given you a sense of the historiography of what people seem to know and what seems to have been erased. The biography, he was born in Ampuli, in Lumpur. People tend to portray him as having been born into a poor family, but he was actually born into one of the wealthier families in the village, albeit a village. That's a picture of his older sister and her husband. So he ordained as a novice, he ordained as a monk, went back to his natal village in Wat Banpang in Ampuli, decided to move the temple to the top of the hill next to the village. The villagers agreed. And so that's the temple's location now. It's a view from the top down to the village. And everybody got together and helped move all these stones and make these walls. And then the arrests begin. He's first detained at Wat Li Luang, and there's a debate about the date. Some people say it was 1908, 1910. I think it was about 1915 for a variety of reasons I won't go into right now. You're like, what? This is the Jagannath Kwan Li. And then there were various times that he's detained at Wapata Haripunchai, once for as long as a year. And when he's at Wapata Haripunchai, crowds are starting to gather, and the final time, the local officials are afraid they're not going to be able to contain the crowd, and he's moved to Wat Si Dun Chai in Chiang Mai, and this is where he was detained, and then moved to Bangkok, where he stayed at Wat Benjamin Bo Phit. Suspected that could be. He then comes back from Bangkok, becomes abbot at Wat Pusing, and this is when he starts the building phase. So he's all over the north building, and some people are contributing money, and others are contributing rocks and stones. And then he builds the road up to Doi Suthep, and then we get the next arrest in 35. He comes back, he vows never to return to Chiang Mai, and resides at Wat Jamathevi in Amphoon, restores the temple there, and also restores, builds a new Wihan at Wat Man Ban, which also wasn't finished before he died, and his last major project was this bridge over the Ping River, which he also didn't complete before he died. So here's a picture of him shortly before. He got sick as he was working on the bridge and died in 1939. And even his cremation ended up being controversial. His body was at first kept at Wat Ban Phang, and then officials came and asked to move it to Wat Jamathevi. And so I can't point to it, but in the middle is the place where he was cremated. And that was controversial. The whole thing, there were monks who refused to go. It was, you know, I'm not going. Others were going. But in the end, there were so thousands and thousands of people who came to his cremation. And people said that after the cremation, there were so many people trying to get his ashes that they ended up digging a hole a meter deep. So let's look at some of the things that are absent in this historiography of Kubasi Vijay, and look at the political factors behind the arrests in 1920 and 1935 to 36. So he faced 8 charges in 1920. They are ordaining without permission, failing to obey superior monks, failed to attend meetings to inform monks about new regulations, failed to decorate the temple for Rama the VI's coronation or anniversary of the coronation. The other monks were copying him. Failed to assist civil officials in charge of registers of population, registers of monks. Failed to attend Ampo meetings of abbots, and the other monks were copying him. And the rumor that he had Indra's magical sword, the Siguntai sword of social justice, and also makes rain. So was his conflict within the Sangha or with the state? The Sangha verdict was very mild. They found that he was only guilty of the first charge, and he'd already been punished for that, so enough already. Innocent of the last 5 charges, insufficient evidence to make determination on the second and third charges, given the ambiguity of whether it was a secular or monastic authorities that had issued the summons to Sivijaya. And it's interesting, in the light of the current day, to read the Sangharat's comments about Sivijaya's failure to decorate his temple in honor of Rama the VI's coronation. In this case, the illumination, etc., must be done by those who wish to do it themselves, and the officials who tell the Wats surely do so, only to let them know the time. If the observance was made compulsory, that would be a mistake, for it would mean no honor to the king. When Prat Sivijaya did not comply with this suggestion, he could not be called to account. And the Sangharat then gave him money for his return trip to pay for the train trip back to Lampung, and everywhere he went, there were thousands of people waiting to make offerings to him. So if the conflict was actually not within the Sangha, then what was going on with the state? Well, I would suggest there were two things that were relevant at this point. One is the Military Conscription Act of 1905, which did apply to Montong Payak in 1913. And the second was the Ordination Act of 1913, and I'm not sure when it actually was applied in the North, but I suspect probably right away. According to the 1913 Ordination Act, approval for both monks conducting ordinations and, this is significant, individuals being ordained. So I think the issue was that the individuals had not received permission, not that Kubasi Ujjayi was not an appropriate person to conduct ordination ceremonies. Yeah, individuals being ordained had to be given by a representative of the Department of Religious Affairs, so this is a secular body. And this is a direct quote from the Bangkok Times at the time in 1920, the Bangkok Times Weekly Mail. About 5 years ago, he proposed to ordain a new priest, and he sent the Kamnan and the headman of the village to ask for a license from the Gomakan in Nayampu. They were told that the license would be issued later, and that meantime they could be preparing for the ceremony. The priest did make the preparations and whatnot, which cost some money, and when it was near Lent, he again sent the Kamnan and Puyaban to get the promised license. This time, it was definitely refused. Taking the view that there was nothing wrong in it ordaining an honest person, the priest carried out the rite without a license. So, to understand why did everybody get so upset, somebody ordained somebody. I mean, surely that's a good thing. So what was the big deal? During this period, there was a strong belief in the Maitreya Buddha, the future Buddha. This was a time of economic hardships, increasing military conscription, and changing Sangha-state relations. So I'll discuss each of these briefly. So it was a time of poverty, disease, earthquakes, hailstorms, all contributing to a millenarian atmosphere. The central Thai government was gradually expanding, starting to conscript police, beginning at the turn of the century. Switching to the poll tax, and if you couldn't pay the tax, then you were arrested and had to do corvée labor. Many of them worked on the railway and the tunnel. And by 1916, the train arrives in Lampang. And this is when then any surplus rice in this area is being shipped south. So this is contributing to growing famine. There's a lot of teak logging. The teak is being floated down the rivers and the streams, damaging the dams and the canalways. And because now there are district officers and the indigenous administrative system has been changed, nobody knows who's in charge. So the dams are not getting fixed, further contributing to famine. The missionary accounts reveal that this was the worst outbreak at this period of malaria in the past 20 or 30 years, in which thousands died. Smallpox, the worst in 20 years. This was also the time of the influenza epidemic of 1918, which was a global epidemic, but also hit Thailand and northern Thailand. And as if all of that weren't enough, there was also outbreaks of rinderpest that were killing the buffaloes and oxen that were needed to plow the fields. So it was a time of drought, floods, pestilence, and famine, all contributing to a millenarian sense and a desire for Maitreya to be born. So after the Shan Rebellion of 1902, the Central Thai government set up Army Divisions headquarters in Chiang Mai in 1903. Under Rama VI, there's growing expansion of the military. The Wild Tigers are developing. And we have World War I. And so basically, more and more people are being drafted. We have the Military Conscription Act, which for Chiang Mai in 1913 was written so that it expressly states that monks that don't know the Dharma are not exempt from the draft. Monks normally are supposed to be exempt from the draft. But this was written so that it said, prapti me utam. Monks that don't know the Dharma are not exempt. And so that meant that if you did not read and write in Central Thai, which is how this was interpreted, you could be drafted. And so Kubawa Fayin, who was the Sangharat at the time, was very upset and apparently stormed into the Siamese commissioner's house and said, are wars and tigers now besetting us on all directions? Is that why you're now taking novices and monks off to be soldiers? And there were changes in Sangha-state relations. So the Central Thai Sangha was, it seems, much more hierarchically organized. This is a quote from Crawford from 1828, but I think it probably holds true for the turn of the century. The sovereign himself is the real head of the religion of the country. The Talapoins depend on him for subsistence and promotion. They have neither rank nor endowments independent of his will. They are not hereditary. They have no civil employments and no tie which unites their interests with those of the people. They may therefore be considered as a kind of standing force, ready at all times with spiritual arms to enforce obedience to the will of the sovereign and to strengthen and aggravate his despotic authority. By contrast, the Northern Sangha was more independent and was understood to be a check on secular power. So there are various accounts. So when the ruler of a kingdom wanted to appoint someone Sangharat, he would say to the Sangharat, so are you going to obey the laws of my kingdom? And of course the Sangharat said, yep. And I think that's a direct quote. And then the Sangharat would say to the ruler, if I ask to spare the life of someone that you have sentenced to execution, will you spare his life? And the ruler says yes, to Bintabachivit. So I've actually come across several cases of this happening here in the north. And another key point is that villagers chose the person that they wanted to ordain their sons. So all of that then gives you a sense of what was going on in that decade before Sivajaya is investigated in Bangkok in 1920, and why the population as a whole were looking for somebody that carried Indra's Sigenjai sword. So what was going on behind the second arrest, about which even less has been known, and I'm actually still in the middle of trying to figure this all out, and I know that some of you have expertise in this period, and I'll be very interested in hearing what your ideas might be. So, one explanation would be some religious factors. So, parents choose their ordainers. The way the Northerners did their altar, it's not different levels, it's historically flat, and the images are not the Buddha and his two disciples, but are rather all Buddhas, and very often five. Inside they have organs, particularly the heart, and so Northerners tell me that Central Thai Buddhas are jigma. They don't have hearts. I think that has multiple meanings, and I'll be interested for people that are Central Thais to tell me if this is true. Northerners were appalled at the idea that commoners would keep their ashes anywhere near a temple. That even Kuba Sivijaya died outside the temple because he didn't want to pollute the sacred space. And a strong belief in the Maitreya Buddha. So the five Buddhas, Gotama being fourth, and Maitreya there in the middle being the coming Buddha. But those differences don't strike me as earth-shattering that you need to arrest a famous monk and disrobe hundreds of other monks. Okay, there were artistic factors. A lot of people might have thought that Kuba Sivijaya did old traditional, you know, maintained the old customs. Well, actually, he was quite a modern builder. Now you know why I'm interested in cement. He did reinforced metal with cement. And so there were some people who thought his buildings were ugly because you could still see the rods in the windows. he built these huge, enormous constructions because cement allowed that. So this is Wapatatonlun in Payao, and you can see from how small the people are just how enormous that is. And this is in Merim, the sleeping Buddha Wapraman. And he seemed to like this kind of gaudy colored glass. So perhaps some people thought this was garish. And this is the ceiling in Wapanpan, which they're still waiting for someone to offer to complete, by the way. So there were differences that were forming between the monks who were supporting Sivichai and those who were starting to work with Bangkok. The ones that were with Sivichai had separate ordination cards, apparently, with the stamp of the tiger, because Sivichai was born in the year of the tiger. And this is the person on the on your,
let's see, what is that?
On the right is the Jagannath Jangwai of Watongyu in Chiang Mai that was doing the disrobing. So that you can, that's kind of a scary group of monks, I would say. There he is. But the artistic factors, the religious factors, don't really seem to be an explanation that's sufficiently compelling. So what was going on politically and economically? Well, there's the World Depression, 1929 through 39. 1932, we have the transition to constitutional monarchy. It seems to me that the Kanaga, the group involved in the 1932 coup, didn't have very strong connections with the North. So I'll be interested to see if people agree. Payapahun did come to the North, brought a copy of the Constitution, and it appears that he did meet with Sivichai. It's my understanding that that's supposed to be him in this picture. And here is Sivichai with a fan from the Kanaga. So there were some contacts. After the elections in 1933, we know that Sivichai had a very close working relationship with Luang Siphakat, who was the Chiang Mai MP. But I suspect that from the view of Bangkok and the Kanaga, they saw Sivichai as more closely aligned with the northern aristocracy and the aristocracy in Bangkok. King Rama VII and Queen Ratchathani came to Wapasing in 1927 and met Kuba Sivichai then. Jokeo Nawalat worked with Sivichai, building the road up Doisutev and other projects. Jiao Daarasamy had died, so I'm trying to figure out, 1935, what was going on. So Jiao Daarasamy, who could have possibly played a mediating role, had died, but on the other hand, she didn't like Kuba Sivichai's aesthetic sense. She thought his designs for what's on dog were disgusting, and wrote to that effect. She didn't say they were disgusting, I'm putting words in her mouth. And then there's the Bawarade Rebellion of October 1933. And Jiao Bawarade himself was the Ugarat for Northern Thailand, was the one who was involved in sending Sivichai to Bangkok in 1920, and he was married to a Northern Jiao. So what was his role in all of this? The suspicions, the attitude that the Kanaga would have had towards Bawarade. And Jiao Kawilawu, who was married Jiao Piao Nawalat's daughter, was raised by Jiao Dara, and during the Bawarade uprising, he was the one that drove the train that took the royal party south to Songkhla during the Bawarade uprising. So I can imagine that Bangkok was rather nervous about just what was the political positioning of the Jiao, of Chiang Mai. Then Rama VII abdicates the throne, March of 35. Luang Anasan Sumthong, who was one of very influential figures in Chiang Mai, died in October of 1935, someone else who might have been able to mediate. And we have a shift in the political positioning of the government. So instead of being pro-British, we now have a pro-German, pro-Japanese stance. Field Marshal Fry Kublin Song Kram, Minister of Defense. We're getting increasingly militarized. And I think there would have been concern about the relationship between the North and the Shan states, particularly Chengdong. A lot of intermarriage between the ruling families of the North and the Oxen Caravan traders. And Ponisi, whom I interviewed some time ago, thank God, because he has since died, was told me that he was waiting to ordain until Kwasi Vijaya returned from Chengdong. And another hint that there may have been relationships between Kwasi Vijaya and Chengdong is in the marble that was used to build the Wihan at Wabanban. So marble would come from the Mandalay Shan State area and was delivered by Oxen Caravan. So one can imagine that Bangkok was really wondering what this man born in the year of the tiger, how he was positioning himself vis-a-vis these global powers and shifts. When you consider that in order to build the road up what Patadri Sutayip, Kubasi Vijaya had built an incredible network of monks and followers all throughout the North. These are just some of the people that we've interviewed. This is together with Anthony Irwin, who's sitting over there. He had me riding on the back of his motorcycle. Thank God I survived. These just are some of the people who worked with CBGI in Chiang Rai province. He had a vast inter-ethnic following, Karen, Yang, Shan, Chinese elites. Many of these would have been British subjects, extraterritorial privileges, many of whom may also have been pro-British. So there was the Shan Rebellion in 1902, that was here in the north. The Bombay Borneo and other logging companies had a lot of Shan Burmese workers with extraterritorial privileges. Growing anti-Chinese sentiment. Ngo Anasan, Sutong, and many others were Chinese heritage. They were close, strong supporters of Kubasi Vijay. This, Lohana-san used this to bring food to Kubasi Vijaya while he was at Wetsi Dantai in Chiang Mai. And Chek Ngo provided the car, which is in the museum at Wat Mon Pan now. And these are some of the people that I interviewed. Her stepfather was Chinese, one of the people who poured cement that Kubasi Vijaya hired for pouring cement. Wei Tong Kam is the daughter of Chek Lim, who built the Wihan and the Basad for Kubasi Vijaya's body at Wat Pan Pan. This is also the time of the Sayasan Rebellion in Burma, 1930-32. More than 1,000 rebels killed, another 9,000 surrendered or captured. So Bangkok would have been watching that. So it's a time of increasing militarization, cultural nationalism, fear of British subjects, desire to reclaim the lost territories, and fear of revolts. So I've summarized some of the key moments. And so we have a press now for cultural homogenization, very appropriate Thai dress, and we have the Education Act of 1935, which was strengthening the pre-existing Education Act of 1921 that wasn't really enforced very much. That all children between ages of 8 and 15 must be enrolled in school. So we have increasing cultural conflict over language and religion. People want to go to the temple in order to learn the sacred script in Gamelung, and they don't want to go to school in order to learn Central Thai. And this particular fellow, his father was imprisoned for 5 nights until this individual agreed to go to a Central Thai school rather than to the temple school. So it gives some idea of how harsh the pressure was at that point. And this fellow went around to various temples collecting the palm leaf manuscripts because he was worried that they were being destroyed and burned. And so he has them nicely collected in his house. And here's a graph showing, which I can't point to, but if you look at the period of in the 1930s, you can see a dramatic rise in the number of kids that are going to school. Gives you a sense of the pressure that was being placed on villagers to send their children to schools teaching Central Thai. So, concluding remarks. The erased moments of Kuvao Siwitai's biography are actually some of the most important for understanding Thai history of the 20th century. The mass disrobings of monks and novices determined to protect the Northern Thai Sangha against militarization and secular education must have created vast discontent. I think it underlay the rise of the Communist Party in the North in the 1940s and 50s and 60s, underlay some of the sentiments of the Red Shirt Movement. And I think the date of April 21st, most people when they write the history of the process of nation state formation in Thailand will say the North was integrated into Thailand at the turn of the 20th century. I would say it was April 21st, 1936, the day that Kuvao Siwitai agreed to sign that document. That was the date that marks the end of Northern resistance to Central Thai control. In the 1900s, it was only the Zhao who had agreed to go on to salary. But in 1936, the population as a whole succumbed. The key issue that in the challenge that Kuvao Siwitai faced, I don't think it was within the Sangha. I think it was with the state. I think it was the Military Conscription Act of 1905, the Ordination Act of 1913, the Education Act of 1921 and 1935. The issues which embroiled Kuvao Siwitai continue to be relevant today in the relationship between the Sangha and the state, in the role of education, and in the relationship between the military and the monarchy. His life bridged both sides of the 1932 coup, and he found himself under detention at Wat Bantamabopin in Bangkok in both periods. I hope my talk today helps to place Kuvao Siwitai in more than just a pantheon of monks with magical powers. To do less is to do an injustice to his biography and the complex challenges he faced both before and after 1932. He deserves full recognition for his role in Thai history. In effect, his biography is a historiographical challenge to us for how we write history and engage complexities, both moral and political.
Thank you very much indeed, Professor Bowie.